My son for that, he's the one who told me how to do that, okay, but yeah, I think I knew that much. In any case, you know, all credit goes to him. You know, the way I pronounced it, if I made any mistakes, you know, that's my responsibility. Okay. Thanks for having me. I know that I spoke at Jazoon, which was about a week back. And, you know, basically I shot an email to Antonio, you know, who, along with the rest of the team, has made this happen. So I really want to thank you all for being here. I want to thank all of you for coming. And, you know, I will leave some business cards. And, you know, the very easiest way to reach me is rags@couchbase.com. Okay. So I have only 1 hour, and my demo is not quite working right now. You know, there's some problem with the network, as is always, right? You know, feel free to send me an email at any point of time, okay? And if any of you can't hear me, if I'm speaking too fast, speaking too slow, you know, just jump up, do something, and, you know, I will try to slow it down or go faster, you know, depending on how it's going. So what I'm here to talk today is developing in NoSQL with Couchbase and Java, obviously. So before I dive into the talk, I just want to get an idea of how many of you have used Couchbase. How many of you have heard used Couchbase? One person. You better watch out. And the guy is wearing a MongoDB t-shirt. but that's okay. How many of you, you know, have heard of CouchDB or Couchbase before? CouchDB, Couchbase. Okay, that's it. So that's pretty much you know, what I see throughout the world, you know, wherever I've spoken. This is really not a talk about NoSQL. You know, there are plenty of other talks about NoSQL. I'll refer you to some resources that you can go and get some information on, and I'll talk about some principles of NoSQL as well, or NoSQL. But you know, essentially what today's talk is going to be is it's very easy to get started and you know, in NoSQL using Couchbase and Java. Okay. I know that it's a fairly big room, so if you don't mind, if you can hold your questions towards the end, you know, I can do the questions at the end. But if I'm saying something that you think is really, really bad, really, really wrong, okay, feel free to jump up and stop me. Okay. I'm okay. You know, as long as you don't throw any rotten tomatoes and all that. My name is Raghavan Srinivas. I go by Rags. Rags@couchbase.com is the easiest way to reach me. So the objective for today is to get started with Couchbase using Java, okay? And to learn about some really, really, really basic operations. And actually, these operations, you know, using these operations and asynchronous operations, you're able to do something really, really powerful as well. Many of our customers, a lot of them who've used Memcached and have kind of moved on to Couchbase, you know, do millions of operations per second, you know, using thousands of servers, and that's really not completely new, and it's, you know, it's really about speed, okay, and we'll talk about that. And that's possible using some of these basic operations, which are, most of them are asynchronous in nature. So basically what you do is you fire them and really forget about them, okay? I mean, there are ways in which you can kind of keep track of what happened to your operation, you know, using a future object, and I'll talk about that. One of the cool things that about Couchbase is the new feature in 2.0 called Views. Okay, and Views is a concept that was introduced by the CTO of Couchbase, Damien Katz. You know, some of you might have heard his name, right? He came up with this concept, and it's based on what is referred to as an incremental map reduce technique, meaning that it doesn't happen all the time. It happens only when it needs to. Okay, and that's really, again, you know, the idea behind that is performance. And how do you enhance your application with views and queries? Views and queries is, you know, view and query objects that essentially use the views on the server side. And the server side view is a new concept, you know, introduced in 2.0. Is everything okay? I mean, is it too loud in the back or, right? Okay, right. So a little bit about myself. I work as an architect and evangelist. I worked for a long time as an architect and evangelist, and I've spoken at several different conferences. I've taught a number of undergrad and graduate courses in the Boston area, which is really primarily where I've lived in the last 22 years. I still am trying to understand working with distributed systems, because it's not an easy notion. You know, it's not an easy concept to get. And despite the, you know, the over 20 years of experience that I supposedly have, it's not easy to do distributed systems, as you can see. I mainly work with Java and Ruby developers as it comes to Couchbase. Any of you do Ruby? Or, yeah? Okay, that's fine. And I also have this philosophy, it's better to have an unanswered question than an unquestioned answer. Okay, I'm not quite sure what it means, but essentially, if you have more questions towards the end of the talk than at the beginning of the talk, I think I've accomplished my goal. Okay, so I'm not going to claim to have a lot of answers here anyway. So the agenda is pretty straightforward. We'll do at the introduction, look at some of the operations. We'll look at some talk design in the context of what we refer to as beer data. Okay, beer is, you know, popular with developers, so we'll look at beer. You know, very simple. Beer is brewed in breweries. Breweries beer, brew beer, and there is a relationship between the two. And how do you kind of express the relationship, in Couchbase? So we'll take a look at that. We'll look at queries and views, and then do a roadmap. Okay. So there is actually quite a bit of material for about an hour. So for those of you who are wondering what is NoSQL, okay, this is a simple introduction, or you know, this is what NoSQL is. I'll let you read this for like a couple of minutes. Okay. So basically, somebody put, I'm an expert in NoSQL, and that's how I kind of started. I'm not an expert in SQL, something like that. Do you want me to wait for a little bit?
Okay.
Okay. Okay, this is from Geek and Polk. Got nothing to do with me. I'm not a creative guy by any means, but I thought it was pretty cute. But most of you know that the origin for NoSQL was essentially about kind of scaling up versus scaling across. Okay, NoSQL is really about scaling horizontally and then scaling vertically, because scaling vertically has its limits, as we'll see in a little bit. There are a number of principles that you kind of need to keep in your mind. The first one being cap theorem. You know, how many of you have heard of cap theorem? Quite a few. Okay, that's good. Essentially, you look at consistency, atomicity, and partition tolerance. Okay, so amongst these three properties, you can have only two properties at any point of time. That's what the cap theorem states. As simple as that. Okay. So if you look at traditional databases, what they do is they do consistency and availability really well. They were not focused on partition tolerance as much as they are now, right? Most of the NoSQL databases, on the other hand, is really about not scaling up, but really about scaling horizontally, right? And that is why partition tolerance is kind of a given with most of the NoSQL systems. So Couchbase is really, is partition tolerant and is also consistent, okay? Sometimes it's not available. So it's referred to as a CP system. And there are other taxonomies when it comes to NoSQL databases. You know, like there are graph-oriented databases, there are document stores, there are key-value pairs, and so on and so forth. The way to characterize Couchbase is that it's a key-value pair, but it's really more of a document-oriented store. The key-value pair comes from Memcached, you know, which has a number of different applications, you know, literally thousands of applications. The document store comes from CouchDB. Basically, what happened was Memcached and CouchDB came together and became what is referred to as Couchbase. So a lot of the APIs that you're going to see today is really Memcached, you know, because Memcached is the more popular version amongst the two, okay? Or at least more used version amongst our customers. And slowly, they're starting to use the new CouchDB features as well, like views and so on, that are going to be continually added, to Couchbase. So essentially, C for consistency, A for availability, P for partition tolerance, only two at any point of time. And what Couchbase does is it does consistency and partition tolerance. That clear? Okay. So there's also this eight fallacies of distributed computing. I don't know if anybody's seen this before. Oh yeah, same people, right? So I got to watch out for these guys. So essentially, it says the network is reliable. The latency is zero, right? You know, none of these are true, right? Network is is not reliable. I can see that here. I mean, it's not that it's not reliable. You know, it's because I'm using somebody else's network, you know, where I'm supposed to be a guest, and there are some limitations on what I can do, I guess. But in any case, you get the point, right? It's not the same network everywhere, right? So there are some things you have to adapt to. The bandwidth is infinite, you know, absolutely wrong, right? You know, it never is infinite, right? The network is secure, can't be. Topology doesn't change. And this is one of the big things with Couchbase. The idea is that it's very easy to add nodes and remove nodes, okay? It does not happen automatically. There is a press of a button, you know, you have to rebalance or you have to do something, right? And I'll see if my demo is working, if I can try to show that. But, you know, it's very easy to add nodes and remove nodes, you know, just as easy as pressing a button. There is only one administrator, again, far from true, right? Really, you know, the people are adding nodes, you know, removing nodes. As a user, I tried different things. You know, it should be really easy. So I'll not go through all of this, but the idea is that rather than you as a developer worry about this, let the infrastructure worry about this, right? These laws have been known to be there for years and years and years, okay? But the idea is that, you know, how can you, as a developer, use the same APIs, but let, you know, the infrastructure take care of taking care of these fallacies. That makes sense? Okay? So maybe I'm going a little bit slow, but, you know, I'll get to it in a little bit. So we all started doing distributed systems, I don't know, you know, at least 2-3 decades back, right? You know, distributed systems are not anything new. Essentially, we start off with a monolithic application, right? And then we suddenly realize, oh my God, you know, my application grew from like 2 users to 200 million users. Now what am I going to do, right? That's the problem that everybody would like to have. Everybody like a Facebook, like a Zynga, like a OMG Pop would like to have. And actually, all three of them are customers, okay? They use Couchbase. And essentially, the way you deal with it is, at the web tier at least, you add more, you know, web servers, you know, maybe add a load balancer, and you're ready to go, right? You know, the web tier, it's fairly straightforward to add, you know, more servers and kind of scale it horizontally. There's a blog that was written about 8 years back by a person from, you know, Unix world. His name is escaping me at the moment. But basically what he wrote was, I don't really like to scale up. And there are a number of different reasons for not scaling up. Because if you want to scale up, basically what it means is you have to throw away your old system and you know, essentially buy a new system, right? Instead of that, it's better to kind of do something like this. You know, like rather than scaling up, you want to scale horizontally. I mean, I've said that already 10 times. Maybe I'll say, you know, 10 more times, okay? But that's the idea. So essentially, if you want to add more commodity web servers, very easy. You know, there's a plot here of system cost versus application response time, right? And essentially what this says is, as the number of users grow, right, you know, your application response time, you know, is pretty much, you know, linear. It's not really suffering badly as the users grow up, right? And that's for the web tier. Okay, but when you do is, if you keep growing your database, you know, meaning you're scaling up, right? Then what happens is, you know, it's fine until a point. At some point, the costs really exponentially grow up, but worse than that, what happens is the application response time becomes really, really bad. Okay? So basically, it hits a wall. So, you know, your scaling up can go only, you know, to a certain degree. And that's really the theory behind many of the NoSQL databases, okay? So you cannot really keep scaling your Oracle database or your whatever database, you know, MySQL database, whatever that is, right? In an unlimited manner. There is a limit to that. Whereas, if you're scaling horizontally, you know, there is really no limit. And that's the idea behind most of the NoSQL databases. So, like we saw before, you know, adding more web servers, no big deal. You know, your application response time is linear, more or less, right? But your database, really what happens is it kind of goes up exponentially, your cost grows up exponentially, and your response time also really deteriorates, right? So what you would like to do is, instead of it growing up, you want to flatten it as much as possible. You know, try to make it as linear as possible. And that's the idea behind, you know, Couchbase. So what you do is you want to add more servers in your area, okay? So rather than scaling up, you know, scale horizontally. That's in theory, that's the simplistic view of Couchbase, and I'll simplify this even further. So what is Couchbase? It's basically a multi-tenant document JSON-based store, meaning, you know, you can have multiple tenants, you know, they can be listed in the same bucket. Bucket is a concept that Couchbase uses. It's very similar to a database slice. It's distributed, it's fault tolerant, persistence, replicas, and all that. You know, the fault tolerance and all that is handled by the infrastructure, so you don't have to do anything. Essentially what happens is, you know, for every key, there is a consistent hashing algorithm, you know, which hashes it to the same server, and if that server is down, then it's gonna seek the appropriate server, and the same thing happens in reverse when you try to get it. So the infrastructure takes care of this, and we can talk about this consistent hashing algorithm in more detail later if you want to. But again, the idea is that that's the secret sauce, you know, behind what we supply, okay? So let the infrastructure do, you know, all the dirty job, right? And you as a developer are gonna program to the same APIs. Persistence, replication, and schema free, or what I would like to call it, a schema flexible. Okay, it's not completely schema free, but I'll show in some examples, you know, in the demos later, that you can, you know, adapt to some changing schemas. It's simple, it's fast, and it's elastic. Okay, very simple API. It's based on the Venkatesh API, which is publicly available. It's really fast. Like I said, you know, millions of operations per second is not something that's a complete surprise to us. You know, it happens all the time. Predictable scalability, and you'll see, you know, if my demo is working again, what I can do is, you know, I can show how we can rebalance, and essentially you will have an equal distribution of keys, you know, across the multiple servers once you rebalance. So if you take a node away and rebalance again, you know, those keys will more or less uniformly distribute because of the hashing algorithm. Okay, again, more or less is in, you know, is in quote, or that's the way it's supposed to work. Elastic, easily scalable. You know, you can add and delete, you know, don't worry about it. You know, it's all taken care of. I think one of the key things about Couchbase is it's very easy to set it up and up, you know, get it up and running. You know, I do, traditionally I do at least about, you know, or at least initially when I joined Couchbase, I would do at least about 20 installs every day. You know, it's very, very, very straightforward to do that. You know, I was testing some Hadoop connector that I was working on, so obviously I had to install Couchbase every now and then, and you know, it's very, very, very straightforward to do that, okay? I recently taught a course, and, you know, people were having problems with their IP addresses. So basically I told them, you know, don't even worry about, you know, changing your IP address and all that, you know, just reinstall it, okay? The little bit of the architecture of 1.8 is it has a data manager and a cluster manager, and the idea is, you know, keep it separate. The data manager uses what is referred to as a SQL-like engine, and this is the persistence engine. And the persistence layer is based on SQLite, which is going to be CouchDB, you know, going in the future. And this is the cluster manager, which essentially has the heartbeat monitor, the process monitor, and all that. And one of the key things about Couchbase is that there is no master-slave relationship. Okay, it's all, you know, all nodes are equal. Okay, so if you connect to one node, you're really effectively connected to the cluster. Okay, and the client libraries handle, you know, everything that's needed when a particular client goes down, or even a client that you're connected to goes down, because it knows that there are other nodes participating in the cluster, and it'll, you know, it'll wait for a certain timeout. If that node doesn't come back, then it'll, you know, it'll send that key to the appropriate server that's available. And again, all of that is taken care of by the infrastructure. The cluster is based, cluster manager is based on Erlang, you know, pretty reliable infrastructure. But I think, you know, we are reaching the limits of Erlang, so it's going to be rewritten in C and C++. I don't know if any of you seen this, or you saw it recently. Okay. But that's, again, you know, an implementation detail. You know, from a developer perspective, you don't need to worry about it. So very, very straightforward. I set the value of a key. It hashes to a particular server. Okay, and essentially, the Couchbase server itself, you know, remember there is a cluster manager and a data manager. You know, they act you know, basically they act in unison, and essentially what they do is they take the key, persist it, and replicate it as appropriate. You know, you can specify how many replicas you want and all that is handled by the infrastructure. Yeah, pretty straightforward. So to simplify this really, really further, how many of you have used hash APIs, hash table, hash set, you know, in Java? Everybody, right? You know, pretty much everybody. So essentially you provide a key, you provide a value, you say set, and it'll set the key and the value, right? You know, if the key is there, you know, it's gonna give you an error and give that, right? Something like that, right? But what happens is, when you have to do it in a cluster, and you really don't want to worry about, you know, what level of memory is there or what level of persistence layers are there, right? You know, for example, memory might be the fastest, right? You know, and typically it is. Then you have a second level of cache, which might be, 20 times slower or something like that, right? Then there might be a third level, which is really SSD or something, which might be 200 times slower. And then there might be the disk, which is really 200,000 times slower, right? But you really don't care about all that. All of that is, you know, is taken care of by the APIs. So to simplify what Couchbase does, is it's really a key value pair, you know, if you think about it, right? But there is a little bit more to it than that, in the sense that if you persist your value as a JSON, okay, then what it can do, it allows you to do is it allows you to slice and dice your data in multiple different ways, okay, using views. Okay, that's kind of the cool thing. Like for example, if I do a name and a salary, and I want to index on salary, or if I want to index on age, or if I want to index on zip code, you know, like for example, give me all the coffee shops in Paris, okay, or give me all the coffee shops in Rotterdam, this chance, right? You seeing it right? No. Anyway, you get the idea, right? So essentially, you can kind of index it in multiple different ways, if you put it in JSON, okay. So the way to look at Couchbase is that it's a document-oriented store and it's a simple key-value pair. You specify the key, you specify the value, it persists it. You specify the key, it's going to retrieve the value. You don't really care, you know, what happens behind it. Is that fair enough? Okay. So you might think, you know, what's the big deal? You know, I've seen this all before. But again, the idea is that, you know, if you want to do it as a cluster, right? And if you want to, like I said, worry about different levels of persistence, you know, as an application programmer, you really should be doing, you know, you should be worrying about it. One other thing is, you know, you can say that, you know, I can write my own sharding algorithm. You know, I can say, well, you know, everything from A to L is going to go to the server 1. Everything from M to Z, okay, is going to go to server 2, right? And what happens now if you add 2 more servers, right? So now again, you know, I have to deal with A to E goes here, E to, you know, so you get into situations where the sharding algorithm has to adapt, you know, to the changes in the topology, which is really not a good thing to do, right? Let the infrastructure worry about it, and you as an application developer are just going to use the same key value pair, and it's going to automatically get distributed with replicas and all that, and that is the responsibility of the Couchbase server. Is that clear? Okay. Any thoughts? You know, anybody has any questions that you think? You know, I can take one question. Yeah. Right. A little concerned when there are no questions, but yeah. Anyway, that's all right. We can get started. So if you put it in JSON, okay, there is some meaning. You know, you can add to the data. Essentially, what I'm doing here is 19 to 95, maybe 97.5, 97.8, whatever, percentage of your use cases are based on key value pair, right? So you specify the key, you get the value. Specify the key, you get the value. You specify the key and the value, you persist it. You know, most of those use cases are like that, right? But let's say I want some use cases where I want to do it in, you know, a little bit differently. Like, for example, you know, like I said before, get me all the breweries, you know, that are in the Paris area. You can't do that with a key value pair. Okay, that is where, like I said, you know, JSON is useful. You can really slice and dice it in any you know, different way. There is one characteristic or one field in beer called ABV. ABV stands for alcohol by volume. Okay, so you know, basically, it if you want, give me only the beers that have alcohol by volume more than 10, or 10 or more, whatever, right? Because, you know, I want to drink, you know, I'm a macho man, I want to drink some real good beer, right? Then, you know, you can do that as well, okay? It's not, again, it's a case which, you know, might be in those corner cases, like the 20% of the use cases, or maybe the 2% or 1% of the use case, but still it's, you know, it's definitely there. And that is where JSON is important, and that's where secondary indexing comes into the picture, and that is where views come into the picture as well. Okay, and I'll talk about this. So let's get started. How do we get started? You know, the first thing you probably want to do is install Couchbase. How many of you have installed Couchbase? I know that nobody worked on Couchbase, right? Okay, 2-3 people. Okay. You know, out of the two of you, did you install CouchDB or Couchbase? Couchbase?
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, thank you, okay. It's available really on any operating system that you want, okay? It's mainly available in 64-bit, I should say mainly available. It's not available in 32-bit on the Mac, okay? But other than that, you know, it's pretty much available across the board, okay? Pretty straightforward to get it up and running. If you've tried it before, if it takes me 2 minutes, you know, I'm sure all of you can do it in half the time. Because it's really, I mean, you don't need a DBA to install this, okay? No offense to, you know, Oracle DBAs or any DBA or anybody, okay? By the way, anybody from Oracle here? Sorry? Yeah, I just gotta watch out for this. Okay. So how do I connect to the server? You know, very, very straightforward. I don't really care, you know, how many servers are there. I connect to one of the servers. The way I connect to the server is I specify the server name, okay, and I specify the port name. And this is a legacy thing in Java. You know, if you use some of the other client libraries, like the Ruby client library, you don't even have to specify the port name. You don't even have to specify the host name. Okay, it'll connect to the local host. Okay, so it'll kind of assume some defaults. But in Java, you know, Java being Java, right? You know, you have to specify. There is a little bit of boilerplating happening. Okay, so you have to specify, you know, the code, the server name, the host name, or the port name, and there is a bucket name that you also have to specify. Essentially, I specify, you know, default bucket. In this case, you know, every instance has what is called as a default bucket, which is essentially an unauthenticated bucket. Okay. Which means you can really do whatever you want with it, right? A typical Couchbase server installations, you know, is the Couchbase server is behind the application server. Okay, Couchbase server is seldom exposed, you know, to the web tier directly. You know, typically it's behind the application server. So, you know, authentication is not one of you know, the main requirements, or at least that's not what we hear from many of our customers. So it sends back a REST-based message. You know, everything is REST. Okay, if you can do it in REST, you can do it in Java. Okay, essentially we have to use, you know, you have to do the same REST APIs. But essentially what you do is once you specify the connection, okay, you are completely immune to any of the network topology changes. So if the network topology changes, essentially what happens is when a new node is coming online, for instance, the client library maps, or the client maps, are updated in the Couchbase client. You know, this is all part of the client library, so you don't have to do anything. It knows what are all the, you know, the nodes participating, and it's going to do the appropriate thing. Okay, here's a little bit of code. I specify the list of URIs. I really don't need to specify all the URIs participating in the network. Okay, I really need to specify only one of them. Okay, but there are some reasons where you may want to specify the list. Yeah, especially if you're using an older version of the Couchbase client library, which is really, you know, compatible with this as well. And like I said, you specify the host name, which in this case is localhost. Okay, you can do it on your laptop, you can do it on you know, on Amazon, whatever you want. Okay, specify the host name, the port name. This is again a legacy thing. You specify /pools, and then you specify the bucket name, which is default, and specify the password, which in this case, like I said, is unauthenticated. Okay, and you're ready to go. Okay, so once you get the client, you can use any of the operations that you want to do. And what are those operations? You know, pretty straightforward. You know, we'll see that in just a little bit. But essentially, to use, you know, to get started with the connection, you also have to use some of the client library dependencies, okay? And I've listed some of this, the common codecs, the jettison for JSON processing, native for HTTP comment streaming, and these are all, again, jars that are used by the Java client libraries. You don't have to do anything. If you use a Maven project, okay, Eclipse, through NetBeans, or through the command line, you know, it will download all the dependencies for you. If you don't like to use any of those, if you like, want to use IntelliJ, if you want to use the command line, no problem. Okay, all that you need to do is make sure the jars are in the appropriate class path. Okay, is that okay? You know, very, very straightforward use. So once I have my connection, right, then again, like I said, it's keys and documents, right? So essentially a key is a string without space, and you know, there are some more restrictions with that, but you know, I think it should be 255 characters long. But again, you know, not really a problem. A document is a pure binary blob, unless it's JSON, okay? So the server looks at the data and sees, is it JSON, is it well-formed JSON? If it's well-formed JSON, then it treats it in one way. Basically what it does is, it updates the views or whatever it needs to, you know, at whatever point of time, okay? But if it's not JSON, then essentially what it's gonna do is, it's gonna just persist it, just like a binary blob. So you can store whatever you want in there, you know, could be a binary image, could be just a simple value, could be, you know, any kind of document that you need, or it could be just simple JSON as well, okay? So essentially, JSON adds more meaning. There are some operations we'll see in a little bit which are really relevant to non-JSON. There are certain operations which are you know, relevant to JSON, okay? Essentially, the views and the queries. So there is metadata associated with the data as well, as you may, you know, as you may infer, right? The one thing that you know, is used is the expiry, the TTL, or time to live, as it's called. Okay, so essentially what this is it's a time for the data to live. Okay, so you can say I want it for 30 seconds. Okay, a lot of you know, database programmers are just shocked by a concept like this. They're like, what? After 30 seconds, the data is gone? You know, I mean, that never happens in a relational database.
Yeah, you know, true.
But, you know, there are a lot of instances where you may want that document to go away after a certain time, right? So I know that Bastille Day is July 16th, right? So you don't want something after July, is it July 14th or 16th? 14th, I'm sorry. Anyway, so you don't want something to persist after July 14th, let's say, right? You know, you may have invitations for Bastille Day, which is valid only until July 14th or, you know, 12 a.m. or something like that, right? So there are a lot of instances where you can have the time to live, and you can specify, I want it to live for this amount of time or for, you know, exactly this time. So meaning it can be relative or it can be absolute, all right? Then there is something called as CAS, which, you know, is the check and set or the compare and swap. And essentially this is used for implementing concurrency. A lot of these things, you know, you have to implement on your own. You know, there is no concept of transactions in Couchbase. You know, you have to do it yourself. You know, that is where, you know, sometimes the trade-off between SQL databases and NoSQL databases come into the picture, right? It may not be the answer to all of your problems. It's certainly not a panacea, right? But there, you know, there is no reason to normalize the heck out of all the data, relational databases want you to do, right? And it's really up to the application, and I think I had a discussion just before this talk, where, you know, can you provide me with some guidelines, you know, of whether my application is suitable for NoSQL? I don't think I can give you an exhaustive list, but you know, the idea is that if you think that it's working reasonably well with relational databases, then I think, you know, relational databases are fine. But when you reach a point where, you know, performance is key, where simplicity is essential, where you're taking, I don't know, if you're employing more DBAs than developers, right? Again, nothing against DBAs, you know, they're great guys. Okay. But the idea is that, you know, if your focus is really on development and you have to do too much system administration, then, you know, maybe you're reaching the limit of your database, Okay, that's where you have to start thinking about NoSQL. Unfortunately, again, in this talk, I really don't have too much time to cover that. What I'll do is I'll focus on just this. Okay. There is also something called as flags. Okay, but don't worry about it. This is used by Java to serialize, and it essentially uses Java serialization. But if you want to implement your own serialization, you can do that as well. Okay. So essentially, your set takes three parameters. It takes the key, the expiry, and the value. Okay, actually, I lied. You know, you can have four parameters as well. You can specify the transporter as well. So meaning you can do your own serialization as well. But by default, it uses the Java serialization. So a set is very straightforward. You know, it sets the value whether the key is there or not. Add will do it. And if it does not exist, it will return an error. Okay. And replace will only replace it if the specified key already exists. If it's not there, it will return it. Okay, did I say the same thing for add and replace? But you get the idea, right? You know, essentially, one of them is, you know, you have to have the value, the other one you don't need to have the value. Yeah. And you shouldn't have the value. So the TTL can be specified either as an absolute time or a relative time. Okay. So absolute time is you can say 30 seconds from now, or you can say, June 14, 2012. You know, it has to expire at that time. You can do that. And essentially what you do is you do time in seconds or absolute time from the path for expiry. Right? So it may be a little difficult to do July 16, 2012. Right? Because it's less than 30 days. But anyway, you get the point. How do you get? By just using the get, and you specify the key, and you get the value. Okay, like I said, you know, very straightforward. Get and touch, essentially what it does is it updates the time to live. Remember, you know, if I set some value 30 seconds, and if I do a get and touch, essentially that thing is incremented, right? But again, you know, very, very straightforward operations. You know, if you look at this, you know, you're like, no big deal, right? You know, very easy to learn. But again, the idea is that, you know, the infrastructure takes care of these operations. One of the things that bites a lot of new developers is that the set is asynchronous. Okay. In fact, most of the operations are asynchronous, and you'll see that in just a moment. Okay. And the reason for that again is, you know, to be able to do operations fire. Okay, and let that persist at some point. Append, prepend, increment, decrement, replace, and touch. You know, a lot of them are not applicable to JSON. You know, append, prepend is not really applicable. You know, increment, decrement is not applicable either. Okay, it's really more increment and decrement is more for integers and so on. But you know, pretty straightforward. So let's look at asynchronous operations. You know, everybody knows what an asynchronous operation is. You know, essentially what I want to do is, you know, I don't want to wait for the operation to complete. I go to something in the meantime, and then I'll get the value at some point in time. So essentially what you do is, a typical asynchronous call is I use a future object, okay, in Java. You know, how many of you used future object before? Okay, you know, so it's very straightforward. So essentially I have a future object, I do a client.set, okay, specify the key, I specify the expiration time, and I specify the value, okay? So at that point, the set immediately returns. Right? Immediately, you know, quote unquote. Right? So the set really has effectively not happened yet. Right? So when does it actually happen? Is when we do a get on the same future object. So when you do a get on the future object, then you are blocking. Okay, so this is one thing that kind of, you know, I had a tough time understanding it a little bit in the beginning, because your set by nature is asynchronous. Okay, it's not synchronous. So in other words, just because you do a set doesn't mean that, you know, it persisted the value, right? If you want to be sure that it persisted the value, then what you want to do is you want to do a get and wait for that. That's probably not the most efficient way, but that's definitely it guarantees you that. Okay, there are certain other operations that we are adding, in the next few releases called observe, where you can kind of observe what is happening to the value as well, okay? Which might be useful in a lot of cases. Even a get can be asynchronous, okay? You just do an asynchronous get, okay? And then when you really do a get, okay, that's when you are blocking, right? So you can do an async get and then do a followed by a get. Okay, is that kind of clear? Now a little bit for the more advanced operations, you can implement concurrency in multiple, actually two ways, not multiple ways, okay? One is the optimistic concurrency and the other is the pessimistic concurrency. Pessimistic concurrency is where I grab the lock, I hold it until I want it, the mutual exclusion, right? And only when I'm done, I'll release the lock, right? Standard way, right? But what you do instead is you use something called as a CAS value, a check and set value. Okay, and what you do here is a CAS is a long value. Every time you update the value, it's going to get updated as well. This is the metadata that I talked about before, right? So what happens in this particular case is you get the CAS, and you try to update the value, okay? So if the CAS is the same, meaning that nobody else updated in the meantime, okay, your set is going to succeed and there is going to be no problem, right? But if somebody else updated in the meantime, you're going to get a CAS mismatch. Okay, and it's really up to you to deal with it in the appropriate manner. Okay, just because you got a CAS mismatch doesn't necessarily mean it's a problem, right? So I could be doing some update and somebody else could be doing the update at the same time. All that might be needed is kind of merge the two data, right? I might be doing a review and somebody else might be doing a review for the same, and it's perfectly fine for both the reviews to exist, right? Or it may be okay only for my review to exist. That's really up to the application. And again, you're probably noticing the trend here, right? A lot of these, typically what was provided by relational databases, is relegated to the application. The idea behind this is, this approach is that, your application has to be very simple, very easy to develop, and very easy to maintain the relationships. So compare and swap, check and set, they're both identical, okay, used interchangeably, rather. And the idea is very simple. You provide a CAS value. If it doesn't if it doesn't match, you have a CAS mismatch, and you do something appropriate with it. If it matches, then your set succeeded, meaning nobody else did anything in the meantime. So here's a very simple example of a CAS. Okay, what I'm doing here is I'm getting a CAS value. Okay, and then I'm doing a thread sleep. Okay, and then what I do is I do a set operation on the key. Okay, and I specify the CAS value. Okay, and then what I do is I specify the whatever value I want to store. Right. And then I'm done, I go ahead and do whatever I want to do. And then I do a get, in which case what I'm doing is I'm blocking for that operation to complete, right? The operation is going to complete, and either I get a CAS response at OK, or I'm not going to get a CAS response at OK. So in this case, it's a set fail because, something happened with it, right? And it's up to me to deal with it. So if you run this particular piece of code, as long as you're the only client running it, everything is fine. But the moment you have one more client running the same piece of code, then depending on who got in there first, who got the CAS first, that particular client is going to succeed, the other client is going to fail. Very straightforward. Okay. So a little bit about document design. Like I said, Couchbase server introduces document-based storage, views with indexes, and querying. I will refer you to the Couchbase server manual, which is pretty good actually, which talks about how these views are optimized. They are done in a very lazy manner, meaning that they are very performant, and like I said, they are done in an incremental map reduce. So a view is updated only if it is necessary to be updated. Okay, a view is actually updated only when a view is accessed. Okay, so as long as a view is not accessed, those indexes are not even updated. Nothing is going to happen to that. I mean, you might ask the question, now what's going to happen if, I want high-performant indexes and all that, right? Or I want high-performant views. And the answer to that is, there are certain cases where, or at least 80% of those cases where views are going to work just fine, but there may be certain cases where you may have to optimize it. You may have to put certain indexes in one bucket versus another bucket. There are some rules that you'll have to go through. I'm not going to go through all the rules here. But there are ways in which you can optimize your views as well. So here's, like I said, in a very simple example of beers and breweries, right? Beers are brewed in breweries, and you know, breweries make beer. You know, as simple as that. So the cool thing about this is that, you know, you can extend this schema, you know, fairly easily. Okay, and I'll show some examples, you know, depending on how much time I have, right? But you know, the idea is that you can be schema flexible. Okay, quote unquote. That's the idea behind NoSQL. For example, you know, I have my, you know, my beer, and I have a bunch of information associated with it. I have my brewery, okay? I don't have the latitude and longitude for all of those breweries, right? So if I want my Google Map, map, only for those which have the latitude and longitude, I can get the map, whereas the others, I can deal with it in a different way. So the idea is that, you know, I can add things, I can extend my schema, and it kind of naturally evolves as the application evolves, okay? So the latitude and longitude was kind of an afterthought, all right? Okay, so... So schema is optional or flexible, data is self-contained, and really the main goal is to model the data for your app instead of for the database. A lot of times, you know, you retrofit your application for the database, you know, you look at all the stored procedures, and your application is kind of adapting to the stored procedures instead of for the data itself, okay? So the idea is that, you know, you go opposite and you use the data primarily, okay? So views, like I said, are secondary indexes. They use the map reduce technique. It's based on JavaScript. And essentially, it's very, you know, it's very straightforward. What is MapReduce? In essence, you can emit what are referred to as key and value, okay? And then what you can do is you can do something with the key-value pair, okay? So, like for example, you know, if I'm getting all the coffee shops in the Paris area, right? What I might want to do is I might want to do all the, you know, emit all the zip codes, okay? And then I might say, get me a range of all the coffee shops, you know, in this zip code to this zip code, or, you know, whatever it's called in French, okay? So that's the idea, okay? So you can do something like that. So what views are is to be able to slice and dice the data in multiple different ways. So here's an example of that, you know, let's not worry about that. But essentially what a map does is it emits a row, key value, and a reduce can do, you know, simple things such as count, sum, and so on, okay? Some very simple reduce functions. Or you can add that as well, okay? Let's look at some examples rather than looking at all this, okay? So essentially what I'm doing here is I'm emitting a key and a value, okay? And essentially what I'm doing in this particular case is I'm emitting a particular field and the value is null, because what I probably want to do is I want to index it based on the name and nothing else. You know, I don't really care about the document itself, okay, or about anything other than the document. In fact, in Java, if you can very easily get the document, you know, just by looking at this this particular entity, and I'll show that in a second. Okay? Let's see some examples of that. Reduce. There are built-in reduce functions such as count, sum, and stats. Okay, and here's an example of where I'm adapting to some changing schemas. Initially, I start off with just the name as a field, and then I do a last name and a first name. Okay, and my application is kind of adapting to these schema changes. Very, very simple, contrived example, but nevertheless, you know, drives home the point. Essentially, what I'm doing here is if, you know, if this particular name is not null, then I use the name and email. Otherwise, I use the last and first name and kind of concatenate them or whatever. Okay, so do whatever I want. So how do I use the APIs? You know, very straightforward, this is my map function. What I'm doing here is I'm just emitting the ID, okay, and not really doing anything with it, right? And in my Java code, I use the query, I specify the query, and I do a bunch of properties on that, and we'll see how this is used in the view. So the view API itself, you know, the same map function, but I specify the get view beers and beers. Beers is a doc name. Okay, and beers is the view name, okay? So I specify the name of the doc, this is on the server side, I create that. And basically what the view is saying is, for each document, if it is of type beer, okay, then I emit, and this is typical of Couchbase, where you specify the type information also as part of the document, okay, because all documents are pretty much the same. All JSON documents are the same. So what you typically do is you embed the type information either as a type field or you put it in the key itself. You know, like you could say beer, underscore whatever, right? And a lot of times that will help you in doing some range queries and so on. And again, like I said, there is an entire session on document design, how to design your keys and all that, but I'm not going to go through all that. So essentially this view, I specify the doc name and the view name, and then what I do is I create the query, right? I specify the view and the query that I created earlier, right? Then what I do is I get the iterator associated with this particular result, okay? And now what I can do is I can go through each of the, the rows. Essentially, it gives me back a view response, and I can get the entire document by saying row.getDocument, or I can just do the get value by saying row.getValue. Okay? Is that clear? No, maybe not. There are development production modes and so on. Okay? So here's an example of how I would use this to count the number of beers with the same alcohol by volume. Okay? So I'm hung up on alcohol by volume. Yeah, because, like I said, I'm just obsessed by that, right? So essentially, if type is beer, right? If doc.abv, meaning if there is an ABV, then what I do is I emit the doc.abv and 1. I really could emit anything here. I could just say null also. Because what I'm doing here is I'm doing a count. Okay? So essentially what happens is it's going to emit the key value in such a way, 10, 1, 10, 1, 9.6, 1, 9.6, 1, 9.5, 1, and so on. And then what the system is going to do is it's going to take care of doing the count based on the key value pair. So it will tell me at the end of the thing, how many has 10, how many has 9.6, how many has 9.1, and so on. Okay? So, hopefully you kind of appreciate how easy it is to use views. So what I'll do in the remaining 8 minutes, something like that. Yeah, so what I'll do is I'll do a couple of demos, okay? And then we'll get back to the resources in summary. So how many of you use Eclipse, by the way? All of you, okay, yeah. How many of you use NetBeans? Oh, I feel so bad. But anyway, that's not anything new, okay? So if you're using Eclipse and you want to get started, all that you have to do is import an existing Maven project, okay? And basically go to the appropriate directory, okay, which is, in this particular case, I put it in some HOLs or something like that. Okay, hopefully this is going to work. I go to the exercises, EX2, and there's my example, okay? The first time around, it's going to download all the dependencies. Remember, I talked about some dependencies that you wanted, right? But, since I've already downloaded this, it's ready to go. Okay, so here's my Hello Couchbase. Okay, and here's my precedence file. Okay, and essentially what it is it's taking all the precedence file in the US. Okay, so what I'm doing is I'm taking the precedence.json file here, line 24 that you guys see. Okay, and I'm using JSON library. How many of you use JSON, by the way? JSON? Yeah. I like it, very easy to use. If you want to use any other JSON library, feel free, that's fine too. So what I'm doing here is I'm specifying a connection to the localhost, right? I specify the array list, I add that to the list, and then I specify the list of the URIs, I specify the bucket, and I specify the password, and then what I do is I go through each of the entries of precedent. Okay, and you'll see here that this is the JSON file. Okay, number 1, number 2, number 3, number 4, number 5, whatever. Okay, I use that as the key, and I store the precedence. We do very straightforward, and then I'm done. Okay, is that clear? Okay, so if you want to run this, just run S and run Java application. Hopefully it should work. Okay, so I'm running this in the local host. not a big deal. No, nothing, nothing earth-shattering happening yet. Okay. But let me go back to NetBeans. Okay, like you said, if you want to use any other IDE, that's fine too. And here are some examples of what I'm doing. Is I'm writing some beer. Okay, so beerwrite.java is basically what I'm doing is rather than going through all the 4,000 beers. By the way, this is also an open BeerDB. It's an open source project. Okay. Like any others, they're having some problems supporting it. So if you feel like contributing, go to openbeerdb.com. Okay, and they have like 4,000 plus beers. Okay, my apologies to you if there are no French beers here. I just took 50 at random. Okay, and essentially what it does is French is not really it's not really beer country, right? It's more of a wine country. So I guess you guys won't get inside. So what I'm doing is I'm taking each of the beer and writing it. Okay? So this is very straightforward. I'm going to run this. I have to run this because I have something else that I need to show. Okay, and I'm done. And I'm going to write the brewery exactly same thing. Okay? And I'm going to run this. Right? So, remember my ABV count, right? So let's take a look at this. Let's take a look at this example. Again, same thing. On the client, on the get view, I'm specifying beers and beers count ABV. Okay? Does everybody see this? Oopsie. Hey, it doesn't matter. Co-host 8091. Okay, this is the admin console. Very simple to use. Okay, hopefully it's going to come up. And I specify the password. Okay, and you'll see that it just did a bunch of things. You can look at this, the server nodes. Right now there's only one, and you can take a look at each server. And you kind of look at it by the hour, by the day, by the week, by the month, and all that. Okay. Very simple, like I said, I'm using their admin console, so I'm sure you can do it as well. But let's go by beer count ABV. This is the view that I created, okay? So here's my, can everybody see the JavaScript? Unfortunately, I can't explain this. Function dot, okay, sometimes it's. So everybody see that in the back? Yeah? So essentially what I'm doing is if dot.type is beer, and if there is a ABV, okay, then I emit dot.abv and 1, okay? Is that, it can't get any simpler than that, right? So actually, I could just do this as well. I think this should work too. As they say, never try something that you've never tried before, because the demo is bound to fail, but hey, I'm going to take a chance, what the heck. Okay, so then what I can do is, one of the cool things is you can debug this right here. It will show you the results. And you can see here, 4 undefined, whatever, right? It didn't matter. 4, 2, okay? 2, 1, 2, whatever. 1, 1, 1, and so on, okay? And what happened here? Because I was doing a count, okay? So, what are the other ones? Count, let me do a sum, let's see. So basically what you can do is you can do a lot of debugging right here. Let me save it. Okay, nothing happening? Okay, let me not debug this, like I said, so now you know that it was, you go back to what it was before. but there are other ways of doing this, okay? So I'm going to save it. And show the results and make sure it's working. Right. So 4.5, basically it's in the reverse order, right? You saw that exactly the same thing happened before as well. So what I'm doing here is in the Java program I'm using the same thing, and if U is null then I come up with a error. I create a new query. I set the reduce to true because I'm using the reduce method here, right? I'm counting the ABVs. I'm counting the beers by ABV. I set the state to false, you know, let's not worry about what this means in a, you know, because this is in detail. Set descending to true. Okay, so, you know, like I said, I'm a macho man, I want the ABVs, which are highest ABV to be on the front, in the top, and then everything else below, right? Now, if I set it to false, you'll see that this will be a little bit different, okay? And set group to true, and what I'm gonna do is, just for the heck of it, run it here. Okay, it should give you the exact same result as before, you know, with 4, 2, and so on. And I have exactly 3.5 minutes, okay? But here's another important piece of code. Essentially, what I'm doing here is I'm using two iterators, and I'm using the beer and the beer, the breweries, okay? So I get all the beers. Okay, and then for each of the beer, I go to the brewery and get the appropriate brewery associated with this. This is kind of a outer join, if you will, in the traditional relational database parlance, okay? So what I'm doing here is I'm going to the client and I'm getting a view two. Okay, do you guys see this? You know, view two is client.getView breweries. Okay, and query is new query. Okay, and then what I do is I set the include dogs, I set the stale, and then what I do is I set the key to be beer.brewery ID. So I use the view, the second view, and I get the brewery's IDs that are associated with that particular beer. Okay, so I use like, you know, two views, one view to get all the beer, and then I get another view which essentially gets me all the breweries associated with that particular beer, and that's kind of how I wrote this code. Okay, one last thing, and then we'll be done. Okay, and I think I might probably go a little bit above, but you know, hopefully not too much above. Okay, so here's my presidents.java program. Okay, this is all the American presidents. Okay, I'm sorry, I don't know the French presidents. I don't know my U.S. presidents either, but at least I have the data there. Okay. So essentially what I'm doing here is I'm doing a set on the presidency, like I said before. You know, we saw all that before, right? So one thing I'm going to do here is I'm going to, we're going to take a look at the data, okay, and write it. And essentially if you look at the president.java, okay, I have a presidency, I have a name, Wikipedia entry, whatever, okay? And I don't have a field here called notable, okay? So this is a, you know, field that we'll look into in a second. But what I'm doing here is I'm writing this particular file, okay? And then what I can do is I can go back to my admin console. If, you know, if you want to do it in Java, that's fine too. I go back to my views. Okay, and I look at the precedents. Okay, and I have something called as a notable. Okay, and what I'm doing here, if the particular type is precedent, and if it is not now, okay, then what I do is I just emit the doc ID, the home state, the name, and whatever, and the notable, and I really do now, okay? So and you'll see, when I run this the first time around, okay, what will happen is, you know, hopefully there should be nothing in there, okay, because there is really nothing that has a notable field, okay? Now suddenly I realize, oh, my schema needs to extend, you know, I'm going to add the notable field, okay? So I go back to my Java program or whatever I do it, okay? I already have my data, you know, so I'm going to call it notable. Okay? And if you see the JSON file, okay, you will see that Bill Clinton, you know, has Monica, as you expect, right? Mm-hmm. George Bush has 9/11. Okay, Barack Obama has healthcare. Okay, and just for the heck of it, I'll... Okay. No, actually what I meant was the opposite. Not that it doesn't work. Okay, never worked, there's not I didn't. Okay, that's good enough. You know, I don't want to All right, so let's run this again. Okay, now what I did was I added the notable field, right? So I've extended my schema. Okay, and if I go back and if I run this same, hopefully you should see this a little bit different, okay? So you'll see that, you know, Bill Clinton has Monica and you know, Barack Obama and healthcare, which is about this, okay? Very simple example which shows how you can adapt to, you know, changing schemas, but it really took like, you know, 2 minutes to, you know, to make this happen. So with that, let me go back to my presentation and show you the resource and summary, and I'll try to conclude. So hopefully you'll all download some of the Couchbase servers, you know, look through the Couchbase views in the Couchbase server manual. It's pretty neat. You know, there's a lot of information in there, how the views get updated, how you can optimize the views, and so on. I really, you know, scratched at the surface. I didn't really go in detail at all. Developing with the client libraries, develop/java/connect. If you don't like Java, you know, you want to use Ruby, that's fine too. Okay, PHP, that's fine too. You know, we really have client libraries for just about anything that you want, and I think that's one of the powerful things about Couchbase. The wiki on the Java client library has a number of tips and tricks, okay, of how to use it. And OpenBR database, like I said, OpenBRDB there. Okay, and with that, let's see the quiz. No question? Okay, there.
Thank you. I'm not sure you said this, but maybe you hinted at the fact that you will drop Couchbase. Oh no, or am I missing something in the persistence layer to cloud SQL?
No, it's the opposite. So we are using SQLite right now,
okay.
But we will start using CouchDB.
And one issue I had when trying to use Couchbase was it wasn't really very clear what the different projects were, because there was something that was called the Couchbase single server.
Yes.
There was a Couchbase server, it was in 2.0, developer preview, and was a little bit messy and
I think it's gotten a lot better now. We are really trying to focus mainly on Couchbase Server 2.0, okay? And all the client libraries basically our developer preview right now, okay? I know the documentation is not the perfect. Couchbase single server is gone, you know, it's not there anymore. We used to do something on the mobile side too. You know, we are really focusing on the Couchbase server 2.0 right now. The more frequent question that I get is, what is the difference between Couchbase and CouchDB? You know, and you know, sometimes I struggle to, you know, kind of answer that in the simple reason that Couchbase is really, you know, the roots are from mcached. And gradually we are adding, you know, more, you know, some of the features from CouchDB into Couchbase. Okay, I don't know if I answered your question. Maybe. Okay, we can talk about it.
Can you touch a little bit about the consistency level you try to achieve? You talked about CAS. I imagine you somehow distribute your data by key. So, what's happening in the system to keep that consistent?
Yeah. So, you know, I mean, that's an excellent question, by the way. Consistency has different degrees, and if you go do a Wikipedia search, you know, there are I don't know, hundreds of different consistency levels. Okay, absolute consistency to eventual consistency, and all those terminology. Like I said, you know, we are a CP system. Okay, we are consistent and partition tolerant. So what this means simply means is that all the different servers, you know, should have the same view of the data. You know, like for example, if you do the view, you know, chances are, but you know, it doesn't matter who the clients are connecting, they should all see the same view. You know, but it's not really guaranteed that, you know, they may all see the same view at the same time. Okay, but at least what is guaranteed is that if you put something in, you know, whichever is the last one is the what you should get out. Okay, so. I don't know what degree of consistency that is.
But that's a big brain, you decide to shut down like the small part of the brain, or like that?
Yeah, so you know, I think you're asking the next level of, you know, what happens in read-write consistency versus read consistency. So absolutely, you know, all of those are really, you know, handled by the server, right? So really as a programmer, you don't really worry too much about that. But you know, we can talk about the details of the server itself, but essentially, like I said, you know, it guarantees you the CPU throughout. Okay, I don't know if that's enough, but you know,
it's not to break up anyway.
Sorry.
Yes.
I think that it will be. It's the last question, so
last question.
Thanks a lot, Brian.
Okay. Thank you very much.